It's a very great pleasure to be here, especially in Europe. I'm a chemist, and Europe today is incredibly important because it has this brilliant chemical strategy for sustainability that the European Union has developed. And if they follow through on it, if Europe follows through on it, I believe we're going to have a better future. And so this is a few kilometers from where I grew up. I always walk there when I visit my childhood home. It's a very beautiful place. It's New Zealand's biggest bird wetland. But when I was growing up, it was incredibly polluted, and the entire city looked down on our neighborhood, smelly place. And the New Zealanders, the Aucklanders, decided we're going to clean it up, and they cleaned it up, and they changed the chemistry of what they were doing, and today it is this amazing place. And that's what we do at Carnegie Mellon University and the Institute for Green Science. We design chemistry to clean up chemistry, and we're very careful to check that we're not jumping out of the frying pan into the fire with our chemistry being worse, perhaps, than what was there before. And we do that with very deep analyses for low-dose adverse effects for endocrine disruption. It's really about thinking about the future in the present. And so to give you a sort of an idea of how we might do this, we really need to start negotiating with the future if you think about it. So here's the power of the present walking in and sitting at the negotiating table, the chemical power. Who does it talk to? Well, the future's a phantom. They can't have much of a conversation. So therefore, it takes us, everyone in this room, but especially if, like me, you know the stuff, you really have to speak out. You have to speak truth to power. And if we all do this, we really need a big field to do it, actually. It's just a couple of us that are doing it. We might have a good future where our children grow and prosper and where the other creatures also have a great future. It's about massive change. Now, I'm a scientist. I'm primarily focused in science, but I also live in a culture. I taught the first course in green chemistry, now chemistry and sustainability, starting in 1992. And in the 30-year period that I've been doing that, what I've realized is this is more about us and our character, and us on our not understood things about ourselves in our head than it is about the science. And so I'm going to focus on that today. So what is this thing you're hearing about, endocrine disruptors? This is the initial definition from the European Union. An endocrine disruptor is an exogenous agent, something from outside the body, that interferes with the production, release, transport, binding, action, or elimination of natural hormones from the body responsible for the maintenance of homeostasis. Some lovely lady was telling me she was having trouble keeping her body temperature stable. That's an endocrine-related thing, probably. And then the regulation of developmental processes. That's the critical thing. Endocrine hormones tell cells what to become. The egg and the sperm come together, and something happens, and 9 months later, you have this incredibly complex creature being born. Endocrine hormones are signaling stem cells to become a brain cell, a lung cell, or whatever, at the right times. And if you put chemicals in that look too much like hormones, they end up jumbling up that message, and you get a different outcome from what God intended. Now, I read this book, Our Stolen Future, in the 1990s, the mid to late 1990s, and it changed me forever. It's very clear that it was very powerfully written and accurate. And it meant that chemistry was different from anything that I had ever understood until I read the book. It harkens on from another very famous book that you'll know about, Silent Spring, which actually anticipates endocrine disruption. And the third book in the series was written just this year by my great friend, Shana Swan, and it's about the decay in our reproductive potential. Europe and North America and Australia and New Zealand have lost more than 50% of their sperm count in the males in a period from 1973 to 2011. That's 10 years ago. The line is almost certainly continuing down, and actually if you project it, you arrive with a mean sperm count asymptotically approaching. It never gets to zero, it just gets closer and closer to zero by 2045. Those babies are being born today. Here's the book, Countdown. I recommend that you read it. It's very compelling. I believe that chemicals are the major factor in this effect. Wherever you look at a highly chemicalized society, you'll see low birth rates, and whenever you can pick up on some sperm count data, you can find it's crashing. China is absolutely crashing from the limited data that we have. They're also very uncareful and highly exposed to chemicals. So how do we get here? How have we done this to ourselves? Well, the simple thing is we didn't do it deliberately. It's different when you know there's a problem, how you respond, then deliberation comes right into it. But actually, if you have a chemical technology that does something people want, where somebody can make some money, you get an enterprise. The problem is that we don't want just functional chemicals. We want sustainable chemicals. Every chemical also has a health performance, an environmental performance, and a fairness performance. You know it when you see it, I won't go into it. And so the question is, how can we learn quantitatively to integrate health, environmental, fairness performances with technical and cost performances so that we can actually say, well, this chemical probably really is sustainable, as opposed to somebody can make some money and it does some cool thing, right? That really means that you've got to know whether you've got an endocrine disruptor. It really means that, because I actually think something like 90% of the problems of chemicals have to do with low-dose adverse effects, where the primary mechanism we know most about is endocrine disruption. And so we look here at this group. We got together over 5 years. It's led by Pete Myers, who's in the foreground. We had phone calls, we had retreats, and we produced a brilliant, I think, protocol for figuring out if you have an endocrine disruptor, and we published that in a paper with that title in 2013. I think the European Union is probably reading it because it seems to be developing tests that are along the lines that we suggested back then. Now, again, how did we get there? There's something else that's wrong, the assumptions. There are two incredibly naive assumptions when you look at that underpin the chemical enterprise. The first is that you can make a chemical that's got a cool property, and that's all it's going to have. You know, it's going to go out there and be a good little chemical, like a well-behaved child, and do what you want to do it and nothing else. And the second assumption is that, you know, we're so good at toxicology, we'll be able to figure out if there's a bad actor, a badly behaved child, and we'll be able to pull it out and discipline it. The problem is that toxicology, regulatory toxicology, is based on a 500-year-old idea which is not adequate to deal with endocrine disruption. European Union, make sure you test for endocrine disruptors. It's the most important thing. And when we look to plastics, we can see this echoing all the way through plastic themes. So, for example, the monomers. You heard about bisphenol A, polycarbonate plastic. Holland, you've got all these greenhouses under polycarbonate plastic. When it goes to the landfill, it decomposes and it releases the bisphenol A. The landfill leachate is so incredibly estrogenic because of that, nothing can live in it. The polymers are too stable. We've seen this morning. They're just too stable. We don't have any that break down reasonably. The additives are very often, a large number of them, endocrine disruptors. The recycling, none of them recycle well. None of them. Forget it. It's good to try, but they don't really do it very well. The decay compounds are virtually infinite, and we know nothing about their toxicity. And finally, we have this circular economy, total fantasy, that you can take plastics and recycle them. You get things like people putting plastics into bricks. They melt them and they make bricks to build houses for poor people with good intention, but they don't know enough. The plasticizers are going to be liberated into the house for the lifetime of the house, and you've got people in there breathing the endocrine disrupting plasticizers. You have to know a lot of stuff before you do these things. There's an Everest of scientific information and cultural information saying that we have not been diligent in managing the power of the chemical enterprise. It has tremendous power. And so this is what happens to you when you don't do this. The condition upon which God hath given liberty to man is eternal vigilance, which condition if you break, servitude is at once the consequence of his crime and the punishment of his guilt. John Philpot Curran was an Irish politician and jurist whose life spanned the 16th and 17th centuries. Now, if you haven't seen Dark Waters, see it. It's about a company, DuPont, a company town, Parkersburg, West Virginia, and it's about this town really being poisoned, knowing with the company clearly knowing, over decades. And so there's been court cases that have been settled. So the film is all about that. But what you see is wildly different fates for the key actors. So the people of Parkersburg got a lot more cancer, very high increases in certain cancers, really shocking birth defects, and numerous maladies. What happened to the people that made the decisions? Well, through the key period, the CEO was Charles Holliday. He left in 2008, eventually became to Bank of America and became its board chair. And then he moved on from there to be none less than the chairman of the board of Royal Dutch Shell. He's just recently stepped down. And the second guy, Thomas Connolly, he's currently CEO of the American Chemical Society, where we need to have a very big discussion about the professional society of all chemists, where we need to have a very big discussion about endocrine disruption, and we're not having any of that. This is wrong. Does it look like servitude to you? So this is what the chemical EDC produces. It's like a Disneyland castle as far as their PR goes, where all of the things that they make and give us are so wonderful, and they are wonderful, and we all rely on them, but they're all littered with endocrine disruptors. Everything there is associated with endocrine disruption in some way, shape, or form. What on earth are we going to do about it? So this is another one of these little movies, Civilization's Compass. Here's the compass, and we've got a big guy, he's tough, he makes EDCs, he's got a lot of money, and he's going to pull up on the tail of the needle. And we've got another guy, let's say these are the people producing the CSS in Europe. He's pushing up on the needle, and there's this warfare going on over the direction of the needle, and we need the guy on the right to win. We absolutely need the guy on the right to win. As a species, all of life needs the guy on the right to win. So what does he have to do to win? What do you do? Well, it's dominated, of course, by the fact that he has a lot of power, and this is the guy we need to win. Well, you need to learn how to make profitable chemicals that are sustainable. That requires that you test for endocrine disruption and low-dose adverse effects in general. We need to test for EDCs. We need to move from a money first to a sustainability first and all things civilization. And we need to learn how to love the future. So with EDCs, most money's been leading the world down deadly unsustainable paths. Good sense, goodness, the self and the future good are all trapped in this dynamic. This is what the castle looks like. There's the people in the keep making decisions. They hire scientists to put out data that pretends it's not a problem. It's mostly rubbish. They have people that sound important. They don't really do research. They go around and write essays on why endocrine disruption is overrated. They travel in packs. We have people who, pundits, who talk about how this is a nonsense. And we have people who are making a lot of money, like the Wall Street people and the investment bankers from all of this. We have the politicians who get money from the chemical companies, and we have the men that trooped through the halls of power in Washington and Brussels and tried to persuade people not to look after their future generations. This is our money first in all things civilization. It is failing, and it is failing massively. Mother Nature is there looking at us, and Mother Nature would very much like the European Union to do what it says it's going to do. No data, no problem is what we've got right now. We need no data, no market, and then with endocrine disruption. Okay, you all go to this guy, Andre Rieu. I think he's wonderful. He's amazing. He could go anywhere and leave people with an experience they'll never forget. And here is a concert he did in England recently. They're singing a Christian ballad, The Holy City. Yeah, it's a Latin tenors do. Watch it on, it's fantastic. Watch it on YouTube. And I love the way they pan around the audience and watch the faces of people being inspired by the performance. And at the end of this, they have this lovely lady, and she has tears in her eyes. These are the tears of cultural ecstasy. It takes millennia to build those tears. You got all the music, you've got to be written, you've got all the instruments, you've got to get the orchestra thing, everything. This is what we're losing. There won't be people to cry those tears. Thank you.